Hello, my name is Christian Koos. I am Professor for Electrical Engineering at Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, in short KIT. When the wall came down, I was 11 years old. I remember my father calling me over. He would never miss the 8 p.m. Tagesschau. And I remember seeing pictures of people sitting on top of the wall and celebrating. What that really meant, I could only grasp a few months later when my parents would take me and my sister to a trip to East Germany. At home, I still have a few pieces of concrete in my drawer that I chiseled off the Berlin Wall that must have been in summer 1990. When I was a child, I grew up in a small village. There were many farms around us, and I was fascinated by tractors and farm equipment, heavy machines that could do something actually pretty useful. My dream was to become an engineer, to build such things. I became an engineer at the end, but the things I built are a little bit smaller, but hopefully equally useful someday. Our research breaks the wall towards ultra-broadband signal processing. Generation, detection and processing of electromagnetic signals is one of the most important technical foundations of modern society. We use it for communicating through smartphones, we use it for measuring things in a lab, we use it for detecting chemical substances, we use it for taking images in the hospital, the list is endless. The standard way of generating electrical signals is to use electronic circuits. They work well, but they are a little bit slow, or they are limited in bandwidth, as the electrical engineer would say. So typical bandwidths that we can achieve are a few tens or maybe 100 gigahertz. But what if you want to go beyond that, if you want to go to say 500 gigahertz or a terahertz, and some applications really require that? This is the wall we want to break, and we want to break it by using optical signals. So the concept is illustrated here. Assume you have two optical signals oscillating at frequency F1 and F2, very high frequencies, hundreds of terahertz, and if we superimpose them, we get a beat. And this beat can be fed to a photodetector, and that photodetector generates exactly a terahertz wave at the difference frequency F2 minus F1. That's a little bit boring. We can make it more exciting by using more optical waves at the input and by changing their amplitude. And we do so by using what is called a modulator. And if you do that right, and if you superimpose all the modulated signals and feed them to a photodetector, we can get out a terahertz signal that we want. That's a particularly interesting one, by the way. The key thing here is that the optical tones that go into the system need to be perfectly synchronized. We cannot use just free-running lasers. They are not synchronized. They would create a mess at the output. What we use instead is a so-called optical frequency comb. The way we generate these frequency combs is we use a cavity. In this cavity, we have a short pulse circulating, a so-called soliton. And whenever that soliton passes by the output, it emits a perfect copy of itself. So at the outside, we get a very regular train of pulses, and this regular train of pulses corresponds to a series of perfectly synchronized optical waves. And those waves we use as a clockwork for our signal generator. The key concept of our approach is that we can merge multiple optical signals to form one very broadband waveform. This waveform can have bandwidths of hundreds of gigahertz or maybe a terahertz. That means it varies on a time scale of a few picoseconds. And the picosecond is pretty short. If you illustrate that, if you would look at this in slow motion, you would blow up a picosecond to a second. Then what was before a second would turn into 30,000 years. And that's pretty long. Or conversely, a picosecond is pretty short. There are many applications of this research. One of them is illustrated here. It's communications. So in future, say, sixth generation 6G networks, we face the challenge that we have to connect many devices to the internet. Not only smartphones, but also dishwashers, lawnmowers, bicycles, or autonomous cars. And to do that, we need to subdivide the network into many small cells, and those need to be connected by powerful transmission links. They can rely on terahertz frequencies. They are illustrated in green here in the image. This is one application. We are also looking into analysis of chemical substances by what is called electron paramagnetic resonance EPR spectroscopy. The idea is to look at electron resonances under a magnetic field, and the resonance frequencies are in the hundreds of gigahertz. So also here, broadband signal processing is essential. To me, one of the most important questions is, can we make these systems compact, powerful, and robust enough to be used in real-world applications? Look at this mess here. This is far from being something that you want to pay for, take home, and use in your house. We need to make this much more smaller. We want to do that by cramming all these devices onto tiny optical microchips. Those microchips we can fit into small packages that you can take away in your pocket. That's what we are dreaming of, and that's what keeps us busy.